we are going to talk about the solution manager mainly, and this is like the agenda for you to have. SAP. If you're here, you probably know what I'm talking about. So quickly, for those of you who are not so familiar with SAP, it's like the biggest provider of business management solutions. Basically, solutions that are taking care of the business processes, like financial planning, treasury, sales, invoicing. These are some of the examples, but there are many more. These SAP solutions or products, you won't find typically in small companies or medium companies. These are typically in big companies, like Fortune 10, Fortune 100. So usually SAP customers are big customers. And it's very common in this kind of security conference to talk about a root shell, to talk about vulnerabilities and how to compromise a specific service and how to gain root, gain privileges and execute code. But we are talking about SAP systems. We are talking about systems that are holding the most critical information in our companies. Okay, we are talking about HR information, customers information, credit card information, bank accounts, formulas. So we're talking about very sensitive and private information for our company, okay, in most cases. So if an SAP system is breached, if an attacker manages to compromise the SAP system, then these kind of attacks are also possible. And we have to go up and try to analyze the security of SAP systems like from an upper layer, okay? We should not think as a shell, as a root account, as a service, a vulnerability compromise. We must think on this information as the real valuable information in our company, okay? So if someone manages to break into our SAP system, he will be able to perform espionage attacks like getting the information of our formulas, bank accounts, customers, marketing campaigns, new products, all this information that is usually hosted in SAP systems can be obtained. We are talking about sabotage attacks. If someone manages to, you can do this exercise, think about for a little while, think about what happens is if someone jots down your SAP systems just for an hour, okay, it's not like a week or a day, just for an hour, the company will be losing a lot of money, so because all the business processes won't be able to be executed. Okay, so sabotage attacks are also very, very critical. And according to how creative the attacker can be, the SAP systems, if they are compromised, it is also possible to perform fraud attacks. Like, for example, the attacker might be able to create new employees, to have a lot of salaries into his own account, send the raw material and the finished product to his own warehouse, retrieve all the information from the customers and the payment orders, send the payments to his own account. Depending on the creativity of the attacker, there are a lot of attacks that can be done just because the attacker was able to compromise, abusing a specific service or an interface, the SAP system. Okay, so that's why we need to move from this technical view of the security and to understand that SAP systems are holding the real sensitive data, and we are talking about very important information. As I told you, one of the things that Onapsis is usually engaged to is penetration testing. Okay, so we have a lot of customers that usually ask us for pen test their SAP systems, and what we do is we connect to their network. They give us an IP address or a list of IP addresses, And then after 1 week, 2 weeks, whatever amount of time it's engaged, we return with a list of all the vulnerabilities and all the attack vectors that we were able to execute to those SAP systems. And let me tell you that this is like a brief summary, and the idea is for you to keep that it is really important to really understand the security of the SAP systems beyond segregation of duties and beyond the common understanding of SAP security, because we were able to compromise more than 95% of the SAP systems of our customers when we were engaged in a pen test. And very important as well is that we were only given a list of IP addresses, okay? No kind of access credentials so far was given to us. Okay, let's start with the Solution Manager. What is the Solution Manager? Solution Manager is a component for the SAP infrastructure that is required for every implementation, okay? Even though you don't know what a Solution Manager is, if you have SAP, you have a Solution Manager. Actually, if you're installing an SAP system, you will be prompted with a specific key that is generated by the Solution Manager, so that's why you will need a Solution Manager in your company. If it's not in your company, you have a small implementation, it's probably in a vendor or someone that is providing you with SAP services and maintenance, but you are connected to a Solution Manager for sure. It's usually the central point of administration, so administrators connect to the Solution Manager, and from that point they can apply patches, manage users, do broadcast analysis, monitor. They can do a lot of things from that central point. Okay, so I'm not an SAP administrator, so I can't imagine the number of things that can be executed from the Solution Manager, but it's a lot of functions. Okay. Something to really understand is that it is not holding any business data. Okay, so typically, audits and the auditors, the security auditings, are not covering the Solution Manager because it's actually not holding any kind of business information. Okay, it's only holding technical information, and that's why it is very important to understand. I'm going to repeat it in the conclusions that we need to cover SAP security holistically. Okay, we need to cover all the SAP systems. And we cannot focus only on the productive systems. It's connected to all the SAP systems that you have. And as I told you, administrators connect to it to do a lot of stuff. And if an attacker is able to compromise the Solution Manager, in the end, he will be able to compromise all the SAP systems. Okay? Because of how the systems are connected to the Solution Manager, then in the end, the attacker will be able to compromise all the systems. So this is how it looks like, the Solution Manager infrastructure. You can see, typically, SAP system administrators are connecting to the Solution Manager. They can, of course, connect directly to the rest of the systems, but the most common is the first one. And then you have the different environments and systems connected to it. Okay, and very important here is that we have, this is a typical landscape, okay? Dev, QA, and PRD. It depends on how you define your landscape. It might be configured with a lot of layers, okay? You may have development, sandbox, test, QA, pre-prod, a lot of systems connected in the same landscape. But something to realize is that typically, all these systems in the same environment are connected to the same Solution Manager. Okay, so and these systems are connected with RFC connections. And then, if you are able to go up to the Solution Manager and then go down to any other system, then an attacker would be definitely targeting the less secure system, typically sandbox and development systems, and then he would try to engage in compromising a productive environment. Here you can see that the users in the right side, It's because typically productive environments are the ones that are accessed by your end users, okay, the company employees. Then the rest are by developers and QA. So if you think about it, this is how we imagine the solution manager, okay? This is like a mothership that is controlling all the SAP systems in the landscape. And if you think from the SAP administrator, you may be looking at all your SAP systems from that position. So at this point, we need to focus on something that is very important for this talk. And that is, for some attacks, we won't need anything. But for other attacks, we will need probably an initial compromise. Okay, so we are talking about weak systems, for example, development or sandbox systems, that can be compromised abusing any number of vulnerabilities. Okay, this is BISEC standard. The BISEC is a non-profit organization that was created basically by some companies, including Anapsys, that are devoted to SAP security. And each company is specialized in a specific field of SAP security. And then we all the companies contributed with different standards. And the idea is to make a standard surrounding SAP security centralized, that you can see all the different ABAP security, technical security, roles and profiles, and things like that in a standard and in a place where anyone can contribute. These are like the most common vulnerabilities affecting SAP systems. Some of them can be abused to have like a full compromise of the SAP systems. Some others are more conceptual, like they are dangerous vulnerabilities, but you won't be able to compromise the system abusing that vulnerability. So we are going to use one vulnerability. It's arbitrary. We can use any vulnerability. We can compromise initially the system abusing any kind of vulnerability. So for this, I chose the default standard users with default passwords. This is very common in SAP systems as well. Yes, for this we are using Bisploit. That is an open source tool that you can download from Anapsys webpage. And basically, we are doing a brute force of a specific application server. We are adding a host. This is the IP address. Then we are discovering all the services that are configured in that IP address. And then we are enabling the brute force login module to be able to detect, without having any kind of access credentials, all the default users. So you have to specifically configure this, choose default users, and then when you execute the module, you will have all the default users. This is very common. We end up detecting a lot of default users in the SAP systems. Depending on the version, some versions have less default users than others, but usually there are always default users. So we are going to use this default user in the client 66, that is Substar. So with this user, even though it has not assigned the SAPOL, it can create users and he can assign himself the SAPOL role, profile, I'm sorry. So we have detected the user, and now we can basically connect to the system using that password, and we can assign ourselves any role. We can create users, and something to point out here is that is that there is a logical client separation on each SAP system. This is this is true if the system is properly configured and if all the segregation of duties controls are in place and all the users can do only what they should be doing, and there is no other vulnerability affecting the system, it is usually possible to bypass this, going down to the application server, accessing the database directly, and breaking the client separation, or even with ABAP code, or directly executing SQL code, it is also possible. So if we compromise one client, then this might end up in the full compromise of the system, usually. Okay. So let's say we have compromised one system, okay? So and then we will see what it's possible to be done with this kind of privileges. Okay, so there are some RFC connections that are created by default. If you run the wizard, there is a wizard to configure all the satellite systems and the solution manager. And basically, there are connections created from the solution manager to the satellite system and from the satellite system to the solution manager. And those are the really dangerous one. Okay, when you can, let's say there is an implicit trust relationship from the solution manager to the satellite systems, but if you can go up using any connection, then relying on this trust relationship, you can go down and compromise any other system. Well, some facts: there are trusted connections. You have to configure this. You can choose if you can. If you configure trusted or with stored credentials. Some connections have stored credentials within the connection, the destination, so you can use this destination to access the target system. And the really dangerous one are the back connections, the ones that are going from the satellite to the solution manager. Okay, so I'm going to show you, these two slides are for you to have in the presentation. I'm going to show you now a demo on which, given a specific compromise, initial compromise, we will be able to move from the satellite system, any satellite system, to the solution manager using either RFC functions or just directly logging into the system with a remote logon. And from the solution manager, we will be going down again to any other satellite system. Let's hope this is a demo, so let's hope everything works. I have two SAP systems here running in the laptop. I have another virtual machine, and it's kind of very prone to error. Okay, so I created my own user in the satellite system. This is SR1. This is one of the satellite systems. Because of limitations with the resources, it would be great to have like a typical environment with development, production, and the solution manager. But because of limitations with the hardware, I can't have running on the same machine a solution manager and two different systems. That's why I'm going to jump from the SR1 up to the solution manager and then going back down with using other channel. Okay, so this is isolate the fact that it's the same system. It can be any other system. Okay. So at this point, if the attacker manages to get into the satellite system, he will access SM59. That's a transaction that is actually the one that allows you to edit, view, and change any RFC destination. This is the RFC connection. And then we can see that there are two connections here. One is the back connection is configured with stored credentials, okay? So depending on the privileges of the user in the target system, we will be able to do something. Actually, if we run a connection test, we will see that, okay, it's successful. And we have this other trusted connection. And depending on the authorizations of the user in the target system, so the user needs to have a specific authorization object. But anyway, if we are able to see the authorizations in the target system with the other destination, then we can basically detect which user has this SRFC ACL authorization. We can click here, remote logon, very convenient, and we are now connected to a solution manager. Okay, so using my initial connection, I managed to connect to the solution manager. So now, as you can see here, I'm connected in the solution manager. So I just did a few mouse clicks and I'm there. Other way to do this is to use the back connection. The thing is that the back connection won't allow you to do remote logon. This is because the user is not allowed to do dialogue logons. Okay, so this is because of the user type. But then the credentials are valid, so we can execute RFC functions. And then we can access, because of the privileges of the user, we can access any table in the target system. Okay, so it's very critical. Okay, let's go back. We are now in the solution manager. Okay, so I'm going to do the same, SM59. And we can see all the destinations that were created by this wizard that configures the solution manager. And you can see trusted, TMW, login. Okay, each different connection has its own characteristics, like its own configuration. Some of them has stored credentials, some of them are trusted, depending on the connection. Okay, but we can try to go back to the system. Okay, this is the same situation. Okay, so the user is not allowed to do remote logon, but what we can do is because of the privileges of the user, because of how the profile is configured, the user is allowed to access any table, technical and business tables. Okay, so it's absolutely possible to do something like this. SM, SR1, CLMT, 001, I think. And it's and we can query this table. Okay, this is data. This is one specific table. But depending on the product that we have installed in that target satellite system, if it's an ECC, if it's a CRM, an SRM, depending on the solution that we have, we will be able to access any of the tables, technical and non-technical tables. Okay, so we can download the users, crack the hashes, and get the valid credentials to connect to the system. We can target on the support users. It's up to the creativity of the attacker. Okay. So, as you can see, it is possible from a satellite system go up to a solution manager and go down to any other satellite system. This is one way. The only thing the attacker needs is an initial compromise. Okay, so he needs to compromise one of the satellite systems, but then, again, he will be definitely targeting the less secure systems. Okay. Solution Manager, this component is highly dependent on the gateway. The gateway is an SAP component that is configured basically on every ABAP-based SAP system. And its main function is to communicate SAP systems between them and to communicate SAP systems to external systems. Okay, so this is executed with RFC, the proprietary protocol of SAP. So Solution Manager, as it's highly dependent on the gateway, any attack that we can achieve or we can execute in the gateway will be affecting definitely the solution manager. Mariano Nunez is Onapsis CEO. He had his first talk in Black Hat back there in 2007, talking about gateway and RFC vulnerabilities. So I encourage you to go to his paper, Attacking the Giants, I think it was called. Each one of the attacks that you will find there is also valid in the gateway on this solution manager, okay? Because there are several registered servers in the solution manager, and you can basically execute RFC callback attacks. You can cancel any registered server. You can do man in the middle. Even though there is no business information, there is a lot of very useful and important technical information. So any of these gateway attacks can be used. Well, for each one of the attacks that we are going to be covering, you will have in the slides the protection measures or the countermeasures. Typically, you have to enforce authorizations, configuration of the ACLs, and basically avoid the initial compromise in the satellite systems. Okay. So in the conclusion sections, we will have a broad description of all the measures. There is something that is called CUA, that is the Central User Administration, sorry. And this is something that you can configure to centrally manage all the users in your SAP systems. Basically, each SAP system has its own set of users. And not only his own set of users, but also client-dependent. So you have all the users for each client on each SAP system. Multiply that by environment, multiply that by solution, you have hundreds of thousands of users in big companies. Then how do you do to centrally manage this? You can configure CUA. And this is typically, we are talking about this here because this is typically configured in the solution manager as well. So as you can see in the diagram, this is the same concept, the CUA master and the CUA child systems. So connecting to the CUA master system, you will be able to create, edit, change, assign profiles, do anything in all the systems that are managed by that CUA master. So it's useful for ABAP and Java. And well, the idea is that you can manage all your users centrally. For you to have is that this concept is very related with the solution manager configuration concept, because if you're adding this CUA to the solution manager configuration, then you have a lot of connections. And because CUA also adds another set of connections depending on which systems or which mandants you want to, or clients you want to manage. But you have this back and forth connections again. Okay, so you have connections from the child to the master and from the master to the child. So if you think a little bit about this, you will end up looking at the solution manager connections like something that you need to take proper care, because otherwise you can end up having a lot of connections, not knowing which connection is used for which thing, and this you need to take proper care of this. Okay, so that's the main idea. So it is also possible to do this same kind of attacks to the CUA. The thing here is that conceptually, the solution manager or the CUA master is much more important, because from that system you will be able to create users in all the rest of the systems. Okay, so if you can go up to the solution manager with a few mouse clicks, you will be able to create users conveniently for each client, each system with the profiles that you want. Okay. So more countermeasures. You have this in the slides. I have some more demos, so that's why I want to go fast. So we're going to talk about two more things. The first one is the CCMS. Okay, so CCMS is a monitoring infrastructure provided by SAP to receive events and to be able to monitor SAP systems. Okay. So there is this component that you need to have that is called the SEN, central system. That's the one that is going to be receiving all these events and the alerts that are triggered by the satellite SAP systems. Something interesting in this scenario is that an agent needs to be configured. That's called the CCMS, I don't remember the name, but this is an agent that you install in Java and in ABAP. It's a different agent. And the agent is implemented as an RFC server. Okay, so it registers himself in the gateway of the central system. So again, we have all these gateway attacks possible. So we need to properly secure the gateway. To have really clear here is that it is running under the SID ADM user. So SID ADM user is the user that is running all the subservices. If you can execute code or if you can access this service, you can basically connect to the database, access any file, any resource of that SAP system. So if you manage to compromise this agent or any other process that is running under these credentials, then it's basically a full compromise of the SAP system. This is how it looks like. We brought this to this talk because it's not like something standard, but usually we end up looking at the central, the SEN system, in the same system as the solution manager. Okay. So again, RFC connections are created from the central system to the monitored systems, collect and analyze. The analyze connection is used with the own credentials, so you cannot abuse that. It's using your own credentials. Okay. The collect destination is configured with a specific set of credentials, very low privileged, but still there are a lot of RFC functions that can be executed. Okay. So there are connections back from the agent to the SEN system with using these stored credentials that are located in the path that you can see. This is a proprietary format, so the credentials are stored of the CSMRISH user. It is a low privileged user, but still there are some things that you can do. Okay, so how an attacker would be able to attack the CCMS agent? There is a specific function exposed that can be used to execute commands, okay, without authentication. So as the agent is executed with the SID ADM privileges, then arbitrary commands will end up in the full compromise of the SAP, of the monitored SAP system. So let me show you a video. For this, we are also using Bisploit. The beginning is basically the same. We have two modules, specific modules to detect if the agent is a CCMS agent and to execute code through the CCMS agent. Okay, so basically, you configure the target. So here, something very important is that this IP address is not the IP address of the satellite system. It's the IP address of the gateway of the solution manager or the SEN system. So the concept is very different. The one that is used in Bisploit is pointing to the solution manager or to the SEN system, but actually the code is being executed in the satellite systems. So you have to discover the RFC servers. You have to configure the TP name. This is a very guessable TP name because it's based on the host name of the satellite system plus subccms 4x dot the instance number. Okay, so it's very easy to guess the TP name. Then if you run, okay, we have to enable the module to detect if the agent is a CCMS agent. And if we run this, you will see that the vulnerability was detected. It says RFC server with that TP name is probably a CCMS agent, okay? So because the bisploit interacted with the proper RFC functions and detected that it is a CCMS agent. So it's exploitable by the CCMS OS exec. And then if you run the exploit, it creates a new shell. You have to start the shell, and then let's see what happens. So at this point, the only thing we need to execute this attack is the IP address of the send system. Okay, there is no, well, basically we need the host name of the target system and the instance number, but that's not like something you cannot guess. Okay, so it's very easy to guess that. You don't need any kind of access credentials or anything. So if you run that command, then you have basically command execution in the satellite system with the privileges of the ADM user, seed ADM. So at this point, you can access the database. You can do anything. I think I'm doing that. OK, yes. I'm also executing SQL commands. I'm sending it to a specific file. But you have to point to the set of credentials that are configured in the application server. This is the user master table, USR02. And if we run that, we can access then the results that, as we are accessing directly the database, we don't have any kind of client separation here, okay? So it's all there, all the information. I accessed this USR02 table, but there's no restriction to access any other table, okay? So I can access any business table, anything. Okay, so there's another component that is called Solution Manager Diagnostics. For the previous one, the CCMS, we have to specifically configure this, okay? So we have to have the requirement to have this and specifically configure this. The Solution Manager Diagnostics is pre-configured because it's installed on every new SAP system that we install, okay? So if you see another SAP instance, number 97 or 98 called SMD or DAA, that's the Solution Manager Diagnostics agent. So this agent is installed by default, so you will find this on every version of every SAP component. It's developed in Java, and it's exposing a specific interface, P4. This is an interface, a service to remotely instantiate objects. So let's see what we can do. There are two things that can be executed using this. So the SMD agent, once you configured it, it's connecting back to the solution manager using high privileged credentials. And these high privileged credentials are configured in the satellite system. So if you can decrypt the credentials, it's the same process as for decrypting the secure store. Then you can have a set of credentials to connect to the solution manager. And there is this other attack that you can execute, and this is using the P4 interface. You have a lot of methods exposed, and then using these methods, you can basically grab information, but you can also install an application. Okay, so if you can install an arbitrary application, of course you have to code it properly with the proper interface, and it's a Java WAR file, so you have to know how to do it. Okay, but if you manage to create your own application, you can deploy it through the P4 interface. And let me show you what happens here. So we have this. This is not with Bisploit. We have another Java application created for this one. We are pointing directly to the satellite system, trying to detect what's in there. Okay, we have this IP address, and we do an nmap. And we can see this welcome on ports, like 22, 111. We have the 7200 and 69 for the MaxDB. And then we have all the management console ports as well. But there is one that is important for us, is the 59704. That's the P4 interface. And if we manage to detect this interface without providing any kind of credentials, we can initially get information. Okay, so if we run this Java application, we can get information on how the SMD agent is configured, like all this kind of different kind of information, like the version and a lot of stuff. But we will also try to execute commands. Okay, so if we use another parameter that is minus C and the command, basically the application is trying to instantiate a specific object and try to execute command. But as you can see here, by default, service not found exception is triggered because you are trying to execute something that is not there. But it is possible with this P4 interface to deploy your own application, so you execute this minus I, and then the application is going to install all the requirements, all the applications that are that we are going to be using, and then as you can see, installation was performed, so we installed all these different applications that we are going to need. And then if we execute this same command that we have executed before, we will have a different result. Okay, so this is command execution in the satellite system using the SMD agent. So if you execute a who am I, you can see that this is not the seed IDM of the SAP system itself, but this is the SID IDM of the Solution Manager Diagnostics instance. Okay. Anyway, this user is belongs to the sub-inst and sub-sys groups, so you can still do a lot of things. So let's keep going with the presentation. Okay, so we are able to execute code and authenticate it again. Countermeasures. For each one of these attacks, you have the countermeasures. You have the way to protect yourself, your own SAP systems. So I really encourage you to take a look at this and see how you can implement this in your own SAP systems. So some conclusions. A sub-solution manager is usually not in the scope of auditings and usually not analyzed from the security point of view. Okay, so if someone breaks into the solution manager, it's basically game over because he can, depending on how you configure this, you can the attacker can access any other system and all the information in your SAP systems. Trust relationships are necessary because things won't work properly if you disable this, but again, you need to have a proper care, take a proper care of the authorizations, or which user have which authorizations, And this is basically SOD tasks, but you need to do this. You have RFC connections pointing all the systems, okay? Back and forth, all the systems are connected. That's why you need to analyze all the destinations, all the connections, because despite the ones that are created by default, that are the ones that we have been looking at, there are other destinations created by your developers or by some other product. So you have to know which interfaces are in your systems, okay? Because otherwise, we detected in some pen tests the possibility to connect from development directly to production because of insecure interfaces. So that's why it's very important to take a proper care of all the RFC connections. Okay, if possible, it is also recommendable to have a different solution manager for the production environment. Okay, so in this way, you are having a high privilege or very important solution manager, a very sensitive solution manager, separated from all the rest of the systems. Secure the solution manager as any other proactive system, and moving forward with this, secure all the SAP systems as the productive system. Okay, so the real situation is that even though the non-productive systems are not analyzed by the auditings, it is still an open door to the rest of the systems. So you need to know which are the systems that which are the vulnerabilities, which are the systems that you can use to connect to the rest of the systems. And if you end up deciding that you can accept the risk, it's okay, so it's fine, but you need to know which are the vulnerabilities affecting the systems and which are the risks, okay? Yeah, definitely do not expose solution manager to the internet. Restrict network access. This is a general recommendation for all the SAP systems. There is a guide from SAP to telling you how to properly segment, separate the network of the SAP systems from the network of the end users. A very specific set of services should be exposed, nothing but that. Update the systems, use the latest versions, apply patches. This is a very complex task, but needs to be performed. So if you want to keep your SAP system secure, you need to apply the patches and all the latest SAP security notes. And in the end, you have some references. Feel free to access the presentation, all the countermeasures, the conclusions of references. So I hope it helps you. If you have any question, I have some time, I think?
Yes, I think we have about 10 minutes, so if okay. Does anyone have a question? No?
No questions?
Okay, well, actually, I've got a question. You mentioned in the beginning, you said it's quite interesting that not a lot of people show up for SAP talks, right?
Yeah.
Yet, the results of what you're showing, and especially keeping in mind the data that these things are protecting, should actually be completely the opposite. Why do you think that is? I mean, why do you think the interest here, but many other places, is so low?
Actually, because the only people that's coming to an SAP talk is the one that is related to SAP, like the one that's in charge of the security of the SAP systems, an auditor, a penetration tester. So I bet probably most of you are somehow related to SAP systems. So that's why the regular SAP security guy is probably looking at a Windows or Android talk or the more,
that's true,
more interesting or fun talks.
Yeah, it just seems interesting though that if security is your goal and the results you can get with attacking these systems is quite
something okay. That you need to take proper care of.
All right, so thank you very much for your talk.
Okay, thank you.